We will finish this morning session with Mateja Kurir, who is a dear friend and colleague from Slovenia, from Ljubljana. She's a philosopher. She obtained her PhD on the thematic of Freud, Heidegger, and architecture, and she is going to publish her book in short, which is the result of her research work for her PhD thesis. She was a CAS scholar last year. What Mateja said, that it's kind of an important aspect of her intellectual biography, that she works in this moment on the Radio Student, the radio station, and where she develops a very interesting narration of philosophy and the relationship between philosophy and the theory to architecture and urban space. Develops it for the wider plan. Thank you, Mateja.
Thank you. I'm really happy to be here. As I saw, really interesting discussions already yesterday. And well, I hope we'll have a discussion after this presentation I have, which is a little bit of a provocation, you see. For me, in a way, the philosophy of architecture has been already written in some parts. If you look to a lot of philosophical works which were dealing with architecture, especially in the second 20th century, and what I'm going to quote today is some of those readings on architecture and on space that were made by Adorno and Lefebvre. So, what I would like to propose today is to question the entry notion of architecture in philosophy and in theory as such through a view coming out from a distinctive materialist perspective, namely the one, as I said, from Adorno and Lefebvre and space and architecture. Combining their propositions on architecture and space with Marx's view of alienation, I'll try to draw a sketch, attempting to look behind the scenes of the machinery of contemporary architecture and space, that is, a look behind the work of ideology in architecture and space, or to use a term of Walter Benjamin, a look behind the notion of phantasmagoria in architecture. With this triangle between architecture, space, and alienation, I'm aiming to sketch a specific epistemology of architecture, wherein I understand epistemology as a core area of philosophy which is concerned with nature sources and limits of its knowledge. My first question, which is was already drafted also in the abstract, is in a way an obvious one, I would say, for a philosophy or for a critical reflection. So, is contemporary space and architecture alienating to the point that we are so domesticated to this estrangement, we cannot see behind the scenes of this machinery anymore? What was the stand of the philosophers, as Lefebvre and Adorno, for living at the spring of neoliberalism about the veil that covers architecture and makes space alienating already in its roots? Before I continue sketching a possible answer to this question, I would like to transpose my endeavor here to an existing architectural discourse and rephrase my question in a more complicated fashion. As we heard yesterday, philosophers tend to complicate things, of course. I'm referring here to a collection of essays edited by John Bachman. The title of the book is Architecture, Criticism, and Ideology. It was published more than 20 years ago, no more than 30 years ago. In the introduction to this book, we can read an elaborate question regarding architecture and ideology, which Friedrich Jameson is posing in his text, Political Unconscious. And this question is as follows. How is it possible for a cultural text that fulfills a demonstrably ideological function as a hegemonic work to form categories as well as its contents secure the legitimation of this or that form of class domination? How is it possible for such a text, so this text of course is architecture, to embody a properly utopian impulse or to resonate a universal value inconsistent with the narrow limits of class privilege that inform its more immediate ideological vocation? A really, really complex question, and I'm not going to go in the structure of this question. I would just like to make, let's say, a broader context of my questioning today. So, if I try to simplify this question, I would say, how can architecture, as a distinctive expression of the hegemony of the dominant class, with its clear ideological notion, embody at the same time also utopia and some universal values? Is this at all possible? So, many philosophers, architectural theoreticians, and architects were trying to identify the interconnection between the triangle of architecture, space, and alienation with the baseline of ideology. The Italian architects, who for sure Luca knows very well, Aldo Rossi, made a remark which clearly delineates the statement of architecture as a hegemonic work. He says, there are no building of oppositions, because the architecture that is going to be realized is always an expression of the dominant class. It is clear that architecture is and has been exactly this expression of the dominant class in its history, and it's now as well an expression of this dominant class. So it's a hegemony, a special manifestation of ideology. The aim of my upcoming project, the one that I'm doing the class, is to question this seriously obvious statement, that is, every architecture is ideology. So, I would like to step now into this sketch of Theodor Adorno. You can see him making a selfie already 50 years ago almost. So, Theodor Adorno's notion of architecture and dwelling in a modern world. When we talk about Adorno, we are talking, of course, about the prominent leader of the Frankfurt School, which is usually identified with a more general term, critical theory. One of the crucial terms of this critical theory, besides contradiction notions, forms autonomy and nature, was ideology. Ideology, which is present in philosophy since Plato, is usually referred as being a misconception, and was defined by Karl Marx in German Ideology as a specific camera obscura. And this is exactly the notion I would like to underline here today. So, quoting Marx, the ideology of the camera obscura is the one that gives us as an inverted picture of the world, so that ideas and not material process come to be seen as determinary factors. Adorno intrinsically associated everything from the cultural realm with ideology. So we have to have this in mind. Adorno was methodology of Adorno was focused on the historical appearance and material evidence, combining them with the theoretical analysis, which could lead to an objective basis for the explanation of the multi-layered reality of the world. The central focus of his work is aesthetics. Nevertheless, the I don't know if you know, he was also a composer as well. Nevertheless, the central concept of his long career was the negative side of progress, reason, liberation, and that is embodied for him in the concept of the negative dialectics of the Enlightenment. So in his work, the contradictory backside mechanism of this apparent progress, we always have to have in mind that this kind of negative notion in his work, so this progress is essentially linked with reason overcoming myth during the Enlightenment period of the bourgeois revolution and gains his attention, of course, in his negative version. The extremely negative side of the development of reason, of sciences taking over religion and all former beliefs, were in the center of his work. From this perspective, it is easier to understand the radical conception of modern living Adorno was describing in his text, which is imminently crossed, so living is imminently crossed, prevented and impossible, and is located in his work, interesting enough, almost on the same page as that one proposed by Heidegger. In a way, we can see this negative dialectics, the negative part of development. We can read it in the same way as Heidegger was putting it in his critics of about the end of metaphysics. So Adorno remained a harsh critic of the establishment of capitalism, of the totalitarian system, and of the inescapable total system of the Western societies that was characterized for him by the seamless web of media technology, multinational corporation, and international bureaucratic control. That was in the center of his work. One of the founding and supporting elements of this total system were cultural industries, as films, and all other forms of mass distraction, which Adorno put on the other sides of the arts. He found the arts, among which he included also some specific, and not all, forms of architecture, to be the only possible exit from the dominance of the machinery of the total system of the development. We can read his statement, and I quote, "Art is the negative knowledge of the actual world," precisely in his horizon. Adorno's definition of the essence of the work of art is, in a way, one-sided. He says, quote again, "A successful work is not one which resolves objective contradiction in a spurious harmony, but one which expresses the idea of harmony negatively by embodying the contradictions pure and uncompromised." As we will see, Adorno inscribed this urge to embody contradiction also to true architecture. The artworks such for him were Kafka, Beckett, Schoenberg, were art in Adorno's view, so precisely because of their refusal of any form of reconciliation. And this is a possible sketch, a possible, let's say, a possible sketch of how Adorno perceived reality. So Adorno was making a clear distinction between cultural industries such as film, radio, jazz, theater for masses, and other forms of amusement for the crowds, which are on the one of the key characteristics of the total system, and are just one version of consumption, and there is art on the other side. It is important to note that Adorno would always reflect on those topics in connection with the total system. He writes in the letters to Benjamin, I quote again, "Materialistic determination of cultural traits is only possible if it is mediated through the total social process." So here is this sketch I'm introducing on this intersection of total system on one hand and the arts on the other. Adorno included some architecture in these fields of the art, but he was dealing with architecture only in a very in a famous, let's say, essay, Functionalism Today, but also briefly in one of his major book, Minima Moralia. So in Minima Moralia, Adorno's opening line, already the opening line, and also the whole book as well, but already the opening line is quite disturbing. So this is a book that he wrote when he was still living in the States, at the end of the Second World War. He says here at one of the first sentences, that life is reduced only to consumption, and the only way to come underneath this estrangement form is to analyze the objective powers that are determining individual existence. In his perspective, it is impossible to understand an individual phenomenon without grasping the whole, where ideology has a key role. And quote again. So, our perspective of life has passed into an ideology which conceals the fact that there is no life, there is life no longer. Adorno dwells in this intersection between life and ideology on a feature that was essential for the Frankfurt School, and this is culture. And for him, culture is only reduced just to a life. As you see, he is really determinant and not making shortcuts in his work in a way. So in this intersection where life is reduced to ideology, where the whole world is a system of horror, and where culture is clearly a false manifestation, a lie, meant to be hidden the true relations within society, where could architecture like macro architecture be located. Adorno described the whole situation, of course, again in extreme measure, and I quote again, the predicament of private life today is shown by its arena. Dwelling in the proper sense is now impossible. In this context, his view about modernistic architecture, that was mostly known in its functionalist appearance, especially in Germany, is extremely negative. And I quote again, the functional modern habitation designed from a tabula rasa are living cases manufactured by experts for Philistines or factory sites that have strayed into the consumption sphere devoid of all relation of the occupant. Okay, so architecture in his view and this realm is reduced to boxes, to cases for Philistines who do not know what a house is all about, together with a home which does not exist any longer as well. Those contemporaries, Adorno says, they don't know what a house is anymore. I cannot go now into this topic anymore, but I would like to do, in this short sketch, to go ahead with his other text, and this is Functionalism Today, that he published only 4 years before he died. Let me make a short conclusion. For Adorno and Minima Moralia, architecture is not possible as dwelling in the era of fascism and of total system of the Western world are not possible at all. Architecture is just one of the notion of ideology. It just gives a facade to the culture as ideology and works within the dialectics of the Enlightenment. Within the notion where everything is ideology, where culture dwells as a lie, it seems that the only function of architecture is the logical one, and architecture is here just to cover the true anxiety, the alienation that dwells in the world. Adorno will enlarge and reflect precisely this position in his essay, from 1965, Functionalism Today, where he is opposing Adolf Loos in his fight against the ornament in architecture. For Adorno, Loos conceived the ornament from the perspective of the bourgeois work ethics, where the ornament is a repulsive exactly because it doesn't have any purpose. This is why Adorno reads this rejection of a style and the fight against ornament that was extremely for functionalist architecture from the perspective of total system of the bourgeois hegemony, which wants to cut everything, every enjoyment of society. In Adorno's view, and quote again, the absolute rejection of a style, so within functionalist architecture, becomes a style as well. For him, the key attribute for an architecture that will be able to surpass the logical notion of dialectic of the Enlightenment is to work so that architecture will work as an autonomous art. What does that mean? It means that he is striving for an architecture that will be able to look beyond the ideological and to open the uncompromised contradictions that are present in society. Architecture could be autonomous also if the architect would reflect on their work, especially on beauty and modern arts, and also if the architecture will start to fight for their position in society. So architecture in this realm, which should be autonomous and could move itself from cultural industry, should be able to combine two extremes, and those extremes are formal construction and its function. Only the architecture, which should be able to think beyond man and should embody the contradiction in its work, to reflect on its essence and move in its manner to an autonomous position. So this is the first example I was thinking, I came across when I was thinking about how to think architecture as an art. And of course this chapter from Peter Zumthor, the Swiss architect, is an excellent version of such of architecture combining its negative parts when its basic elements were burned out so that the concrete could became a negative version of what it was all about at the beginning. But maybe we can talk about this phase later on in the conclusion. So, This is an enhanced scheme of that I showed before. So Adorno introduces in a variety of quite intensive passages in Functionalism Today a distinction between true architecture and other buildings and interventions in space, which are clearly part of the machinery of ideology. In making those distinctions, he is looking behind the common misconception, and yes, only art can save us, and only art can present us the truth. In Adorno, only the art that embodies this contradiction of society could be in opposition to the global system, and only the one who are critical to the core can express a fight to the dominance in the society. This is also one of the key arguments of Adorno's rejection of functionalism in architecture. As in his perspective, it does not have a critical role in the society, and it is impossible to dwell in this architecture, as this is part of the machinery of the Enlightenment. Adorno's view on society shows, in its negative perspective, the ambivalence, uncanny and contradictory characteristic of the modern times, which are strongly presented also today. So, I'm just making a short step now in Adorno's work to make a conclusion afterwards. If true architecture in Adorno could stand behind the screens of this, if it incorporates its contradiction and reflect on itself, Henri Lefebvre developed an even more radical notion. The distinctive scenery of architecture, the everyday life, is, in his perspective, intensively subjected to alienation, and space is not some neutral entity, but is a product of a specific production of social relation. I would like to propose here a really quick reading of two Lefebvre central books, if we can say that you can choose from 60 books he published, two central, but let's say we can. And I choose here two books, so one is The Critic of Everyday Life and the other is The Production of Space. And I would like to present here this interconnection between alienation, space, architecture, and neoliberalism. Needless to say, Lefebvre was a Marxist thinker who became renowned exactly with the publication of Marxist philosophy on space. In Adorno's world, Lefebvre was tracing the impact of the total system in space and in the everyday life. Actually, so two of his major contributions to the philosophy of the 20th century is to establish this everyday life again, the question of everyday life again into the field of theory. Lefebvre recalls everyday life as a forgotten, neglected entity within theory, because only at this level of practice, so at the level of everyday life, we can see a revolution taking place. In Lefebvre, already the scenery of architecture, the everyday life, so is intensely subjected to alienation. In his three-volume book, there is more than almost 1,000 pages, The Critic of Everyday Life, you can read a quote. Elements of everyday life, so those elements are work, family, and private life, leisure activities, implies an alienation. Although we perceive our everyday life and our neighbors as familiar, this does not mean that we actually understand and we know them, writes Lefebvre. For him, in everyday life, a person is necessarily alienated from him and from herself. Alienation for Lefebvre is at work at the core of privacy of the everyday life of an individual. Precisely, alienation as the predominant feature of the post-war social capitalist system is the best explanation for all of the contradiction and tensions within the society. For him, the wholeness of work, leisure activities, family life and privacy creates a global structure, or the totality of conditions where life is at most colonized by capitalism. So we are most fragile by capitalism exactly in everyday life. At the spatial level, architecture, cities, markets, and other special elements have an a priori determination, as they are clearly ideologically marked by their alienated everyday life. So after the failed let's say, first failed in the Lefebvre school in a way, revolution of 1968, Lefebvre analyze of everyday life was closely connected not only to capitalism but also to the work of the state and also to the work of colonization. And this is a huge topic that I cannot go further as well. But so state colonization in everyday life is a topic which unveils also the important dialectics between the center and the periphery. But I would like to emphasize here that this relationship is also a significant one if we are to consider the epistemology of architecture on the urban level. So going further to his other book, Production of Space, published in 1974, Lefebvre is in many ways collected and enlarged the question of the dominance within space. The core of the book is based, could be based, or I am reading it, that is based on some four formulas. I will present now. So the main issue of the book is not why philosophy with other disciplines originally created many theories on space and then abandoned them, all of them, so that the space eventually becomes a neutral container. This is no longer that is no longer worth any reflection or consideration. The level of knowledge, or let's say the epistemological notion of space, here is of the secondary importance. The French Marxist is primarily concerned here with the social connotation of space. So when Lefebvre asked at the beginning of this book, quote, in which way social relations exist, this is a decisive preamble to understand that he is mainly concerned here with the social connotation and impact space has. The first definition of space, or social space, which will serve here as first of a series of formula, is social space is a social product. I need to add here that Lefebvre points a variety of different types of space. You certainly know among which there are abstract space, social space, real space, ideal space, absolute historical space. The social space is a space created as a derivative of a specific mode of production of a society. It contains social relations of reproduction and production modes which differ from society to society. In the past, societies were created, have created their specific spaces using violence and tricks. This space is the outcome of a multitude of these efforts, and it cannot be in any case an empty neutral container. Saying that, I'm moving to the next formula, and the next formula here is the production of space is a process. Space is produced, it's not simply given. Lefebvre summarizes this thesis, which is at the same time the main theoretical contribution of this book, in a more longer description, and I'll quote here again. The production mode regulates, produces simultaneously with certain social relation its space and its time. Since the space is produced, the focus of reflection should be moved from the space to the social production of space, which is crucial for the reproduction of society and capitalism itself. Besides the social space, the framework also stresses the importance of abstract space. This is the third formula here. Capitalism and non-capitalism have produced abstract space. The abstract space is for him the space of goods, of money, and of the states, which was created by the bourgeois and in which the city had exploded. In the background of production of space, almost in all the Paris book, is a formulation of a strong political program for the interruption of the existing relations of domination. And this political program remains hidden also in the production of space till the very end of the book. And this is the last formula I'm quoting here. Life can only be changed by the production of space. And this calls for a radical twist for revolutions and it screams out from a social paradigm. A really possible case again of how can we change that, but it's, it comes with a list of problems, is, you've certainly heard of that, Habitat 3, the agenda of the UN, how to fight the crisis on a global level, namely in the urban areas. So, to conclude, I would like to highlight some warning signs, signs adorning favorite places within their philosophy, which enables a critical and materialistic epistemology of architecture. The first is, of course, to the intrinsical connection architecture has with capitalism and with the total system of contemporary society. One must be always alert to the social dimension of architecture, and secondly, one has to delineate its connection of what this architecture has with the system. So this would also mean that if a building does not locate the opposition of society, it would not be called architecture in the theoretical method. Going further, every space, a building or every intervention in space is itself, so all these spaces are produced by social tensions and relations. Social, abstract, and planetary spaces are the ones where a radical change in society could occur. The ambiguity of the architectural position, usually immersed in its own production process and lacking reflection, with its currently strong connection with neoliberalism, lays exactly at the point for a new articulation of the core of architecture as an autonomous feature. And this is my very, very last slide, which I show already at the beginning. So, to answer to my opening question, if we are so domesticated to this estrangement of space and architecture that we cannot see behind us scenery and this machinery of ideology anymore, I would say mostly yes. But reading Lefebvre and Adorno, we can find some exits, let's say, some exit points outside this overwhelming umbrella of ideology. As we say, they are both posing negative connotation on architecture, space, and alienation. Nevertheless, there is a positive side to the current to these negative points, and this is two possible exits to the, let's say, to the core of the epistemology of architecture would be: one is art, and the other is evolution. Thank you.
Thank you, Matteo, for these insights. Adorno, I will open the discussion immediately after maybe asking you just for a small specification for somebody that, like me, that touched Adorno really just a little bit. I would like to ask you, which are the concrete examples, I would say architectural or urban examples, if there are any, that Adorno quotes when he talks about the functionalism in general, the autonomy of architecture, and the relation between the ornamental component.
As far as I know, but we have among us, as I know, someone who wrote a PhD on Adorno, so maybe you can maybe add something. So in functionalism today, which is interesting enough, written almost at the beginning of the 70s, so functionalism was already present in architecture for, let's say, 50 years, 60 years. And interesting enough, he is just referring to other flaws, which is, we cannot say a loss is a representative of functionalist architecture, of course. I would assume that he would be going to Germany in between the both wars. But as far as I remember, he is just quoting, he is going to the, let's say, to the core of functionalist architecture, and this core is for him that architecture has no ornament anymore, and that is that becomes in a way striped white boxes, and he traces the spring or the sources of this in loss. So he's working with he's focusing mostly on loss. focuses in this essay. I do not remember that he focuses on or that he quotes anything else. Maybe he does, and I do not remember. But,
sorry, it's interesting to know that he mentions Loos and Corbusier for the first avant-garde, then Charoun in the essay you're quoting, Charoun for the second avant-garde, and in the next essay of the Prisma called The Art and the Arts, he's interestingly quoting exactly what we discussed yesterday, the Vutruba Church in Vienna. That's his prime example, by the way.
Other questions?
I don't think he does he quotes any examples of architecture being the material. So he's saying, as I said, architecture should reflect on itself and should, with this reflection, build its knowledge in an autonomous way, divided from all our knowledge. This is his, let's say, striving to encounter.
Okay. I have a question. You mentioned Sumtra in the chapel, the Buddha Klaus chapel, as an example of negative aesthetics. Is that right? Did I understand this right?
No. I shown this this case. For me, this would be architecture as art, not as negative dialectics. No, not at all. Mm-hmm. For me, this would be architecture that would step out the, let's say, the forcing of the total system of everything of the hegemony of society, and an architect is working with its knowledge, with its design and creative arts in a way, being an artist, an architect as an artist, away from the engineering. And of course, architects always have to have both knowledges. They must have this knowledge of technique in a way. But the solution that Zumter proposed here is completely unfunctional, completely, it doesn't have, he could build a box in this field, but he was trying to make aggregation in a way of the material, because this material that was the first part of the chapter, but you are not, you should correct me, disappeared. And for me, this is a great example of this showing these oppositions in material space. This is what I should
do. Yeah. I will come to you in a second.
So first, many thanks for this presentation. It's, I think, still a task of the future to compare the different neo-Marxisms in European history. For instance, the German tradition is entirely closed on itself, as is the French one. Lefebvre belongs to this French neo-Marxism, which I would localize with the 50s publication Socialismo Valori, where also Castoriadis comes from in the time. And then it's of course Italian neo-Marxism, which is again an entire different story. But it's striking that you end with these two options. German neo-Marxism, especially Adorno, but already performed in Benjamin, have this emphasis on art as the one exit option, as you say. And typically, for the French neo-Marxism, there's revolution, a very concrete action. But both discuss space in an interesting way. Adorno, in the essay that you mentioned, he takes up Schmalzow's terminology. He speaks of Raumgefühl as the one that qualifies Raumkunst, and it's exactly the terminology that you look at, Scandi, have developed before, that Adorno takes up as an option. So I would ask you, now that you step back from comparing these two, what would you personally say? Is it possible to change social relations through an architectural rearrangement of space? Or is the only chance that we have, you know, given the negative dialectics that Adorno works with, that sort of art is anticipating a possible different solution that we cannot think of?
Well, for me, a striking point of Adorno and Minima Moralia is when you read that book, is that I had a feeling that I'm reading a pamphlet in today's journal. It seems that he anticipated our contemporary society 70 years ago in a really profound manner. So your question would be maybe to put it in Le Corbusier architectural revolution in a way. I think that yes, architecture could change society, and what I'm interested in architecture is mainly these social components of architecture, and I think our architects should be aware that what they are building, what they are producing, really strongly affects society, and it can be affected in a minor or in a more strong way. I hope it could change some society in a way, but on the other hand, we can also see the negative point of the, let's say, activistic architecture, which goes from a bottom-up approach, and it's always covered with capitalism again. So maybe 10 years ago, I would say to your question, of course, it can change society. Now I'm not so sure, but of course, this reflection of what architecture does for me is crucial. So that we can try to at least minimalize this notion of alienation and uncanniness and so on in space.
Yeah.
You mentioned in one of your diagrams about all the systems and the arts, when you talked about Adorno, the negative knowledge of actual work. So could you elaborate somehow? I'm not sure how to understand actually what would be, from the point of architect, a negative knowledge, or what would be the positive knowledge, I don't know, the design process.
As I understand it, if we say positive knowledge, we are in Adorno's philosophy, we are at the same moment in the knowledge of society, of sciences. And for him, science is the embodiment of the enlightenment of the dialectics. So this positive knowledge is always a part of the machinery, let's say, the total system. So the negative part would be the ones that are left outside of this negative knowledge. To answer you in a Heideggerian term, that would be poetry, for example, which is not knowledge. Look from the, let's say, core sciences day, but of course it's a great manifestation of man's reflection. I don't know if I answered you. Thank you.
If I may, really shortly, there's an interesting essay of Cacciari. It's a long time ago, 74.
Yes.
But that's interesting because he started in this essay from the manual of architecture of Tafuri and l'architettura contemporanea, and reflect how architecture works on the alienation in the metropolis nowadays. And he refers to Heidegger and Paul Valéry and Gloss, because for Cacciari it's important how philosophy could say something to architecture nowadays, because he said that architecture, especially urbanism, try to reconnect beyond the alienation man to space, to landscape, to refine the sustainability, the life as well. But the most important thing of Heidegger and Loos, the architect, Niels Bohr Reye, is that they construct something, they think architecture, not in functional way. So they explain, they say this rupture. So the critic in as this crisis. It's an interesting way of see alienation and exit, a different exit of alienation.
Yes, thank you. I read this text years ago, and in a way, maybe it could be also connected with what Tafuri, the opening act of Tafuri, Progetto Utopia. He says that all bourgeois art or avant-garde arts of the 20th century, they are aiming all only to distance anxiety. Of course, for me, anxiety is the core feeling of the 20th century and of the beginning of the 20th century. And Heidegger would go, of course, with this along this path. And reading Sven-Olo Wallenstein's book on Heidegger and Gacharya as well, you can find out that Sven-Olo Wallenstein is saying that Tafuri and Gacharya are actually just rephrasing Heidegger. It's painful, but in a way it can be true. It can be true because if you also what Gacharya and Tafuri are saying is that modernist architecture could not be modernist architecture spring already in the 19th century, but it didn't have the technology, and with technology, of course, anxiety and alienation came into space with modernist architecture. So, yes, but thank you.
Thank you.
It's a really great text. Gacharya is now today just a politician in a way, or is that just
No.
Not anymore.
No. No, yes. It's a philosopher.